And well, I think that every Christian struggles with one particular question, and if you don't, you probably should. And that is, what are the ingredients for a successful church and an obedient Christian? Now, in our world today, where the attention span of the average person is less than that of a goldfish, 8 seconds, we kind of want the whole thing summed up for us in Cliff Note version or in 140 character tweets. Lord, just give it to us, but give it to us short and sweet. And although I do encourage you to read your whole Bible, and it's the reason why we teach verse by verse here at Calvary Chapel, it is interesting because 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 12 through 28 kind of give us that Reader's Digest version of how to lead a successful, obedient life as a Christian and as a church. And the exhortations that Paul the Apostle gives to the Thessalonians are really fourfold. I'll give them to you first, and then we'll go over them as we go through this section. But they are how to live without giving your leaders headaches, how to love so that the weak are helped and not trounced, how to worship so that you have proper perspective, and then finally, how to evaluate your environment so you are of the most use to the Lord. And then Paul ends with a promise that if you follow these exhortations, you will see growth in your life. You will see growth and life in your church. So let's begin in verse 12 of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Now we ask you, brothers, to give recognition to those who labor among you and lead you in the Lord and admonish you, and to regard them very highly in love because of their work. Be at peace among yourselves. So just prior to this section, Paul has just encouraged the brothers and sisters in Thessalonica to build each other up. You see that in verse 11, build each other up. Now, Paul's talking not about giving each other a pep talk, you know, attaboy, but really it's about building a structure, constructing a character. Now, to help them, Paul gives this flock these four valuable pieces of advice. Here's where we see the first one, and that is, don't give your leaders headaches. Now, there's no doubt about it, being a leader in a church is very hard work, both physically and emotionally. And Paul bookends his description of the elders in Thessalonica with two words that describe that sort of endeavor. Labor, he says, and work hard. Work hard means to toil. Labor means to become fatigued through effort. The job of an elder or of a pastor, it is hard work. It is fatiguing at times. And Paul really describes that work in two ways, both to lead and to admonish. You see there in verse 12, those who labor among you and lead you in the Lord and admonish you. So leading and admonishing you. To lead literally means to preside over. But I think that the broader context is this: to make sure that the sheep are properly fed and properly protected, as any good shepherd would do, from attack and from temptation. Give the sheep a good balanced diet of teaching, encouragement, and opportunity that will lead to growth. Secondly, they are to admonish. And that word in the Greek means to caution gently. I really like that. So when someone as a leader sees a member of their flock moving away from the character of God, either through attack, being driven away, or through temptation, being drawn away, they are to gently bring them back without harshness. So Paul wants the church to do two things in response to the hard work and labor of their leaders as they protect, guide, and admonish. He wants them to, number one, give recognition and regard very highly in love. Again, you see those in verses 12 and especially in verse 13. To give recognition literally means to be aware. We as members of a congregation need to recognize the hard work of our leaders. We need to appreciate it, and we need to cooperate with them in that work. Then to regard highly, that's one of Paul's super words. The idea is to go above and beyond in showing them not just brotherly love, but agape love. Now, what is one of the best ways to do that? Paul sums it up at the end of verse 13 when he says, "Be at peace among yourselves. Be at peace with one another." And I've got to say, in my 40 years of ministry, the thing that is the most taxing and tiring and discouraging is when brothers and sisters are fighting with one another, when they're hurting one another, when they're competing against one another, or passive aggressively trying to put one down so they can lift themselves up. And by the way, most of this occurs in the individual below the conscious level. People do these things and they aren't even aware that they are doing it. We don't realize that we are engaging in self and other destructive behaviors in opposition to what Paul said at the end of verse 11, to build up. If we would instead focus on building one another up, being aware of the hard work that our leaders do, cooperate with that work, being at peace with one another instead of tearing each other down, the church and church leaders would be so much happier. So then he goes on in verse 14 to say, "And we exhort you, brothers, warn those who are irresponsible, comfort the discouraged, help the weak, be patient with everyone. See to it that no one repays evil for evil to anyone, but always pursue what is good for one another and for all." So this is where we come to the second exhortation of Paul. The first was to don't give your leaders headaches. The second one is to love so that the weak are helped and not trounced. And these exhortations are how we can all then help and aid in creating a healthy church. The first thing he says is to admonish the disorderly. The way that it's rendered here in the Holman is to warn those who are irresponsible. Now, if there is a person who's causing trouble, tell them to stop it. But secondly, he says, comfort the discouraged. There's a difference between somebody who's a troublemaker and somebody who is literally discouraged. If somebody is downtrodden, if somebody is depressed, if they're undergoing a trial, our job is to bring comfort to them, to stand by them, to pray for them, to do good things for them. Then he says, help the weak. And that means to literally provide support for those who cannot stand on their own. Do you know someone who is so weak, maybe physically, maybe emotionally or spiritually, that they just aren't able to carry on? Our job is to stand by them and support them. And then Paul says to be patient with everyone. What great advice that's often ignored. Give things space. Don't freak out. Let cooler heads prevail. Don't react in the moment. Strike while the iron is cold. And then verse 15, again, such great advice, but we tend to think as long as we aren't like physically striking someone that we are following it, where he says, see to it that no one repays evil for evil to anyone. It's like, well, if I didn't hit that person, you know, I didn't hit their car. I wanted to. I don't think that's what's going on here at all. There are so many ways that our human minds have figured out how to get back at others through a look, a bit of gossip, leaving them out of something. And I love what Paul says to do instead of that. He says to pursue what is good for the other and for the church as a whole. So what this means is that before you think a thought, say a word, or do an action, here's what you need to consider. How will this help this person grow spiritually, and how will it help the church to grow strong in representing the gospel? our lives, our relationships, and our churches would be revolutionized if we did this one thing. I so much wish it were more common, but it is not. So then, in verses 16 through 22, Paul focuses on the third admonition, worship to get proper perspective. Verse 16, rejoice always, pray constantly, give thanks in everything, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Don't stifle the Spirit. Don't despise prophecies, but test all things, hold on to what is good, stay away from every kind of evil. Now, in the light of the difficulties that the Thessalonians were experiencing in their city, the admonitions in verses 16 through 22 might seem a little bit tone deaf. Well, Paul, you don't know what we're going through here in Thessalonica. Things are really tough. We're downtrodden. How can you say to always be rejoicing, always be praying, always giving thanks and everything? You just don't know what we're going through. But in reality, I think this admonishment is perfect for anybody undergoing a trial. Here's what he's saying, I think, in essence. Focus not on the darkness around you, but lifting up praise and prayers upwards to God, knowing that He is causing all things to work together for the good. Here's a key thing. We live in the darkness. We experience its effects, but it does not have to define who we are. We rejoice always because God is good in every bad situation. We pray constantly because only He has the answers and we need His perspective. Now, when Paul says pray constantly, it doesn't mean you are literally 24/7 in prayer. What it means is don't abandon prayer. Because oftentimes when we are facing difficulty, that is one of the first things to go. Now, I know when we're in the foxhole, we're praying like crazy, right? But it's in those in-between times, and especially maybe when things are just sort of kind of starting to go sideways, that's the time when we need to actually dive into prayer. Now, he goes on to note that our relationship with God is not a static thing, but it is dynamic. Before leaving for heaven, Jesus promised to send us the Holy Spirit. We should not stifle the Spirit's power and work in and through our lives, especially in times of trouble, when His Spirit should shine more brightly. In those times, we should also be open to those who speak into our lives through the Spirit. Edification, exhortation, and comfort through prophecies. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, Paul talked about a person who prophesies, speaks to people for edification, for encouragement, and for consolation. By the way, I don't really see that operating as it should most times. What I have observed is that people use prophecy in the church oftentimes to focus in on how spiritual they are, how much they hear God, or to underline some sort of doctrine that they're trying to push in the church, or tell other people what to do. I've certainly had people do that to me. When done right, a word from the Lord given to someone else should be edification, encouragement, or consolation, and again, fits right under what I said earlier. It should help the person grow in their relationship with God and to be more useful in His kingdom. Not in your kingdom, but in His kingdom. We should open ourselves up for the Spirit's comfort, even if it's through another person who is speaking to us. After all, the Spirit is known as the Comforter. And the comfort of those who speak on behalf of God into your life is very important. It can play a really vital purpose. However, there are some caveats, as Paul says. He says, don't despise prophecies. Just because somebody is speaking a word that they feel is from the Lord to you, don't go, I don't believe in that garbage. Well, the Spirit does live in you, and He can speak through you into the lives of other people. However, Paul goes on to say, test all things. The Corinthians, not so much. They needed a much better filter on what it was the people were proclaiming to be words from God. The word test there in the Greek, it means to examine, approve, and discern. So we don't just open up our minds to everything that anyone has to say. And this is, as I mentioned, led to all sorts of false doctrine. Instead, we need to see what is said lines up with the revealed word of God and with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hold on to those things that are spoken that are true. Like somebody could come up to you and they could say, I just really feel like the Lord is going to deliver you safely through this trial that you're undergoing, and that he's going to make it all work out okay in the end. That's true. God promises to cause us to arrive safely in his kingdom, and God causes all things to work together for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. We can look at scripture, and it's just that scripture applied at that precise moment when you needed to hear it. That's where we can really hold on to those things that are good, and we can test them and we can approve them because they really line up with the revealed word of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ. So he says, hold on to what is good, but stay away from every kind of evil. If a prophecy comes to you and it does not line up with the revealed word of God, if somebody comes to you and says, did you know that in heaven you will be God? And, you know, I know it's hard to believe, but it's really true. An angel came after giving me some special glasses. I could finally see the truth in his word. And that's what he revealed to me. I know you guys know where I'm going with that. Unless it lines up with the revealed word of God, the Bible we have in front of us here, and the gospel of Jesus Christ, Paul says, stay away, back away quickly from those things. Now, some have argued that what this part of the verse actually means is to stay away. I think one version actually renders it the appearance of evil or the form of evil. And there's a good controversy around that based upon the way that the word is translated and so forth. And I won't delve into a lot of the detail. For my money, I would rather go with the flow of what Paul is talking about here. There's a whole lot of other scriptures that talk about the transformation of our character and not running with those who want you to do evil and, you know, just lots and lots of other things. But I think here, I would like to focus on what Paul is doing in encouraging us to receive comforting words from the Lord, but throwing out the garbage. Okay, then Paul finishes up this letter with a beautiful benediction. Starting in verse 23, he says, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your spirit, soul, and body be kept sound and blameless for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, who will also do it. I love this. You know, first of all, the ultimate aim of God is peace. He is the God of peace. The sacrifice of Jesus Christ brought about peace between us and God. Paul calls us to be at peace in verse 13 of chapter 5. Peace. It is both the cessation of conflict and the creation of oneness. It is the cessation of conflict and the creation of oneness. In this process of bringing about peace, God's Spirit changes who we are. When we use the word sanctify, it's a great Bible-y word, right? It's a churchy word. We become, you know, sanctimonious. But sanctify just means very simply being made like God, having his character. That's what the peace of God, the stopping of conflict. We are now at peace with God. We are part of his family. We can call him Abba Father. He has adopted us, but it's also the creation of a new oneness. He is now in us and we are in him. His Holy Spirit comes into us and begins that process of transforming us from one type of character into another. And Paul is saying, I want that process to run completely. How he says there, may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely. And then he goes on even more and he says, may your spirit, soul, and body. So he says, all of you. I don't want you to just come to heaven and everything else gets burned away. I want you to come to heaven and I want your heart. I want your mind, your personality, the part that makes you, you, and even the things that you do with your body to be kept sound and blameless for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The goal is that when Jesus Christ comes back, he will present us, as Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 5, as a spotless bride. So that process of transformation should go on and on and on in our lives. Now, your immediate reaction to that might be, I am simply too impure. It won't work with me. So Paul adds this fact here, where he says in verse 24, he who calls you is faithful, who will also do it. And I love what Paul wrote to the Philippians in chapter 2, verse 13. He said, it is God who is working in you, enabling you both to desire and to work out his good purpose. When all else fails, it's actually the Lord who's doing the work. And he, and Paul says in Philippians, it's even him that gives us the desire to want to do God's work. I mean, such a deal, right? He pays for your salvation. He cleanses you from your sin, gives you a heavenly home in a place of forever joy and happiness. And then even while here on earth, he supplies everything that you need, including the motivation to become more like him. So then verse 25, brothers, pray for us also. Greet all the brothers with a holy kiss. I charge you by the Lord that this letter be read to all the brothers. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. So three things that Paul asks in conclusion, that they pray for he, Timothy, and Silas. They greet one another. Kind of like, give each other a hug for me. That's kind of what they had in mind there. They would give a kiss on each cheek. That's a common thing even today in the Middle East. And the third thing, that they read the letter openly. And then his final admonition, often how Paul ended his letters, is that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. And I find myself saying this every time I finish one of Paul's letters. Were it not for the unmerited favor of God, we would all be sunk. So yeah. Everything needs to come under the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. So, you know, in conclusion, I think that the last part of this letter, the final half of chapter 5, can be summed up nicely in just two ways. So if you're a note taker, this might be something to write down, or you can check tomorrow on our website, calvarynewburg.org, and you can read the study notes. The first thing is this, admonishment. Don't work at cross purposes with the leaders in your church. Don't work at cross purposes. Find out what the vision of the church is. Find out what the character of the leaders are. How are they serving to guide and protect the flock, to provide them good pasture, protection from attack and from temptation, you know, as revealed by the Word of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ. I have to say all those things because just because a person is leading a church doesn't mean that they're doing it in the way that God might want them to do. So that's important to understand as well. But once you understand that, try not to work at cross purposes with that leadership and with those characteristics. And then secondly, don't work at cross purposes with your brothers and sisters as well. God is doing a work in them and through them. Be a help, not a hindrance. And I think in reality, these two things get summed up this way. Don't work at cross purposes with the Holy Spirit. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, imitate me as I imitate Christ. Your leaders work hard to show you how to reflect God's character in your life. So my advice to you as a member of a church is to be moldable, cooperative, teachable, and appreciative of those efforts. If you find yourself having a problem with a leader, it's important to first ask yourself, is this something with me and my attitude, or is there something they're doing that is counter to their charge that I just detailed for you? And then Paul said, here in verse 23, may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely. I loved what Roger, one of our elders, said in the announcements this morning. He is a walking construction zone. That is how it is with us. You know, I think I might have mentioned this a little bit ago. You know, if we could see spiritually how the Lord sees, as we walk down the road, we would be surrounded by those orange cones. You know, there would be flaggers ahead, you know, slow down, construction zone, be aware, watch out. We're all being constructed. We're all, you know, we're either in the process of tearing up the road or repaving it. And so we need to work with each other in that process, knowing that you might come across somebody and the road's all torn up and it's bumpy. They're not perfect. And you come along and you say, well, how can I help in that construction project that the Lord is doing it? And here's my last piece of advice for this. And that is, this might seem kind of hard, but in your interactions with one another, I would question your motivations first. Think and pray before you react, before you speak, and before you act. Ask yourself again, how can I help the other person grow in their relationship and show the character of God? You might find your reaction has more to do with you and hurt pride than you'd like to admit. So let's do as Paul suggests. Let us rejoice always, pray constantly, give thanks in everyone, hold on to what is good, and stay away from every kind of evil. Be at peace among one another, and always pursue what is good for one another. When we do that, we will be pursuing what is good for all. Let's pray. Father, these things are probably hard for many of us. They're hard for me to hear, Lord. But I pray that you would work these things deep into our hearts so that when, Lord, we encounter opportunities to put these things into practice, you would already have been working on us so that we, Lord, can see your character come out of our lives instead of our old nature operating in the lives of others and with leaders in our churches. Help us, Lord, to be cooperative and teachable and appreciative and moldable. And help us, Lord, to always seek the good of others, seek ways that we can help them instead of just simply help ourselves. Lord, we thank you for the power to do this because it doesn't rest in us. It rests in you. We thank you for this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.